So good to see you. I'm Fred Lewis. This is The Heart of San Diego. The history of our community is told by men and women who have made or are making a difference in our community, the community we call San Diego, and we're brought to you by two wonderful organizations. We're talking about the San Diego Foundation. We're talking about Manchester Financial, helping build a better San Diego. Our Heart of San Diego guest this evening has certainly made a real big difference in the area of the judiciary. He is the Honorable Napoleon Jones. He's a San Diego resident for some 60 years. He's a U.S. District Court judge. He's one of San Diego's most distinguished jurists, having first served as a municipal court judge for 5 years, starting in 1977, then in Superior Court for 8 years, then appointed to the U.S. District Court by President Clinton and confirmed by the U.S. Senate in 1994. He was named Municipal Court Judge of the Year in 1981. He was named to the San Diego Boys Club Hall of Fame, named Judge of the Year by the California Association of Black Lawyers in 1993. He received the Judicial Excellence Award from the Deputy District Attorneys Association. Judge Jones received the Thurgood Marshall Award twice, and we've only scratched the surface. Judge Napoleon Jones continues to be very active in our community, working as a volunteer in many youth organizations and with the California Western School of Law, where he's a board member, with San Diego State and the San Diego Foundation. Quite a life.
Well,
Napoleon, you came here when you were 9 months old in 1940 from Hodge, Louisiana. Why did the folks leave Hodge?
Well, my dad wanted a better life for his children. The South was very segregated, and certainly the opportunities for African Americans was limited, very limited. And so he felt that by coming to California, he would be able to expose us and provide us with a better life.
Picture of mom and dad in more recent years.
Yes.
Napoleon, what kind of little kid were you growing up, first in the Linda Vista area and then in Logan Heights?
I like to think I was a good kid, Fred. I was certainly inquisitive. I liked school. Was very involved in sports. I always have been blessed with friends. So,
did you have any heroes growing up?
Actually, in my home, my parents. My mother and father stressed education. Neither had graduated from high school, but both felt that, and my father used to always tell me, the one thing no one can take from you is your education. And so they made sure that I had the opportunity to go to school.
Went to San Diego High School.
Yes.
What sort of activities after Memorial Junior High first? Do you have any friends from junior high school, people you keep in touch with?
Oh, yeah. There's a very dear friend of mine. We've gone through everything together, elementary, junior high, high school, San Diego State. We pledged the fraternity together, Charles Davis, and he lives in L.A., but we've also experienced Africa for the first time together, China for the first time together, so we do an awful lot of things together.
How much prejudice was there in San Diego when you were growing up in the late 40s and during the 50s?
An awful lot of prejudice, Fred, unfortunately. Not only in terms of housing, but schools. It existed.
San Diego High School, 55 to 58. What sports? What other activities?
Actually, we were the last wrestling team, I think, out of San Diego High to take the state championship, CIF championship. But I wrestled at high school and also in college.
What was your weight? You were a skinny little one?
115.
115?
Yeah, wow. 112, and I wrestled. The limit was 115. In college, it was 121.
San Diego State University. Mm-hmm. You were majoring in social science?
Yes, I received a BA and an MSW in social work, Masters of Social Work.
Why did you decide that you wanted to go into that kind of work?
I've always had a desire to help, to be of service to the community. Certainly, my life's experiences told me that we were losing an awful lot of potential. People with just an awful lot to offer that never really developed that. And I felt that if I could do something to stimulate, to develop that, to make sure that the people would be able to become the best that they could be, then I would be doing a service.
Judge Jones, you were in San Diego State's environs from 1958 to 1962. Mm-hmm. Activities there aside from study, and what kind of environment was it back in the late 50s and early 60s?
Very few African Americans attended State at the time that I attended. I was a part of the Panhellenic Council. I obviously was involved with the wrestling team, fraternity, Oseattle Service Organization, those type of things. And then I was also involved. I was the president at the time of the junior NAACP.
You were in the military from 1962 to 1965. Mm-hmm. Tell us about your activities there.
Crawling. I actually was very fortunate. I had an assignment in Division Mental Hygiene, and so I was a social work specialist, and I actually counseled troops that were having problems.
Came back from the military, went to San Diego State to get your master's, mm-hmm. got your master's, and started in law school at the University of San Diego. You finally got your JD in 1971. Mm-hmm. What were you doing to support yourself during that time?
I was very fortunate. I was married, and actually I was working as a social worker at the time the opportunity came about to attend law school. And that was to a very dear friend, Judge Earl Gillum, who advised me that University of San Diego was concerned, as was the legal profession, with the paucity of minority lawyers. And they were offering scholarships. And I discussed it with my wife, and she said, you know, go for it. Go to law school.
You mentioned Earl Gillum,
yes,
who was a friend of ours, and the number four program we ever did on the Heart of San Diego, mm-hmm. more than 11 years ago. He is a big loss, the fact that he's not here in our community anymore. Did he mentor you in any other ways?
Oh, absolutely. He always had advice. He was a friend, and I could go to Earl and discuss anything. When I was getting ready to take the bench, then he would give me the do's and the don'ts, the things to look out for, what kind of things I should expose myself to. He was just a very, very dear friend.
San Diego High School graduate also, and a very, very good athlete. Yeah. While he was at San Diego State.
Absolutely. And one of the founding members of the chapter of my fraternity.
What did you do after you graduated from law school?
I was fortunate enough to receive a fellowship, the Reginald Heber Smith Community Lawyer Fellowship, and I worked in Modesto with California Rural Legal Assistance.
Did you miss San Diego a lot from 71 to 73 while you were up there?
I missed it, but I was making my trips back, and I knew I would return to San Diego. But in Modesto, I actually became very involved in the community and still have friends that I communicate with in Modesto.
1973, you came back to San Diego and started to sink your teeth into the legal waters mm-hmm. of San Diego. Tell us about what you were doing.
I came back, actually I had a job with Defenders Incorporated, what is now Public Defenders. And a very dear friend, Judith Keep, was working there, so we had an opportunity to work together at the Defenders Incorporated. But I did criminal defense for indigent defendants.
1975 to 77, you were in your own law firm with several mm-hmm. partners.
Right.
What type of law, Napoleon Jones, did you specialize in?
It was criminal and civil, and I did family law, juvenile.
When did you start giving back to the community?
Well, never stopped. Never stopped. I've always been involved in the community. And even in law school, I was involved in the community.
How did you come to be appointed by Governor Jerry Brown in 1977 to the municipal court bench?
Judge Gillum expressed a concern that there was only one African-American judge ever in San Diego.
And that was Judge Gillum.
Judge Gillum. And he indicated that Governor Brown was looking for qualified minorities to make an application for the bench. And he urged me to submit my application.
Cases that you had on the municipal court, then the superior court bench, that some of us might remember. I'm not asking you to take side in the cases, mm-hmm. but cases that you remember personally.
Well, I think probably, you know, anytime you have a death penalty case, it's something that stays with you.
And sure.
I had two death penalty cases, all of the cases, and one of the things that always sticks in my mind, Fred, is what another attorney, Stan Conant, told me. He said, you know, Nap, there's no such thing as a small case. There's small attorneys and small judges, but all cases are important, and if you can't treat it that way, don't take it. So all of my cases have been important for one reason or another.
1984 to 1992, Superior Court, mm-hmm. and then, of course, came the elevation to the District Court, nominated by the Clinton administration, approved by the Senate, I believe in 1994. Am I correct on
correct.
That? Correct. How did you feel about that?
Oh, I was elated. What an honor. And again, I had an opportunity to join two very dear friends, Judge Gillum and Judge Keep.
I have a picture here of Judge Keep. Was this when you were sworn in?
She was the chief judge, and she swore me in.
She's left us.
Yes.
It was a real tragedy. Both Earl and Judith have left us.
That's correct.
And you've missed some friends. I have a picture of you and Earl, too, mm-hmm. that we're going to show in just a few moments. What have been your responsibilities on the district court bench?
Well, we're a court of limited jurisdiction, and I have to tell you that for so many years, we were the busiest district in the United States. Our caseloads
were just unbelievable. Were you understaffed? Was that one of the big reasons?
Understaffed, and we're on the border. What a lot of people didn't realize was that the border cases take an awful lot of time. A lot of people that are not familiar with it believe that they're, quote, simple cases. Nothing could be further from the truth. And we really we had a real load. Fortunately, we had some senior judges, and we do have senior judges that helped an awful lot. Without those senior judges, we would have just sunk. But we do the cases that come in, and it's on a rotation. We're on a wheel. So when our name comes up, we get the case.
This is the Napoleon Jones story, San Diego District Court judge, and a man who's been here for well over 60 years and has a lot of history and a lot of caring about the community in his history. And we'll talk about some of that as we continue on. My name is Fred Lewis. This is the Heart of San Diego on ITV, and we're brought to you by two wonderful organizations. And we're talking about Manchester Financial, and we're talking about the San Diego Foundation. Manchester Financial, building a better San Diego, the Pacific Gateway Project at the Bay, and also Lane Field Project. So they're doing a lot of building and a lot of caring about San Diego, as our guest Napoleon Jones does. And of course, the San Diego Foundation, where you can, of course, fuel your passion, where you can take care and leave a legacy in things that you believe in. What was the first thing that struck you as different about the district court work?
I think that probably the thing that really impressed me most was the border crimes and the volume of border crimes. We obviously on the state side didn't have that many border crimes. So I think that probably, that coupled with the fact that on the state side you enter into a lot of plea bargaining where the judges take an active role in attempting to settle cases, criminal cases. On the federal side, judges do not take part in that at all.
Does that give you a little more breathing room?
It does.
More responsibility in a way?
It does in a way, but I think it also, I felt handicapped. A part of the theory is that the judges can intimidate a defendant. In the 17 years that I was on the state court bench participating in plea bargaining, we did a lot of things, but I don't think we intimidated.
Tell us about the future of the judiciary in San Diego as you see it today. You've served at three different levels. What are we doing right? What could we be doing better?
I think that one of the things that will always bother me, Fred, and I don't think that state judges should be up for elections. I think that the don't retain system is what we need. Certainly there's judges that need to be removed, and the public should have a right to remove them. I have no problem with that. But it just bothers me to think that a judge would have to get out in politic. What are you going to do? Promise them that you'll rule for them if they come in front of you? I mean, it's the third branch is not a political branch, and it shouldn't be made into a political branch.
Do we have too many lawyers in San Diego?
Cream always rises to the top, Fred. I don't know if we have too many lawyers, because with the law degree, you open up yourself to so many different professions. But the cream does rise to the top.
We have a picture here of Judge Earl Gillum and Judge Napoleon Jones. About what year was this taken?
Probably around 2000, 2002, in that time frame.
How has serving the people of this area as a judge changed in the last 25 years or so?
I think that you have more tools to work with. I did a couple of stints as presiding judge in juvenile court, and to mobilize community resources. And it's really true, people really do want to help children. So you have a big pool to draw from, and we just have to develop it. We have to develop it.
One of the reasons I understand that you're so involved with youth in at least four or five different organizations, mm-hmm. including the San Diego Foundation, is your son, William.
Napoleon.
Napoleon. Mm-hmm. And Napoleon was taken from us at an early age. Mm-hmm. Tell us about his death and how it affected you.
Actually, he was on an educational trip. He was a student at Francis Parker, and they were doing an educational trip in Greece. And it was a freak accident, but it left, obviously, a void that will never be filled. He was a very delightful young man, and I reach out with the scholarship that's in his memory, by the way.
With the San Diego Foundation.
San Diego Foundation, and it makes me, it's sort of a mixed emotion, because every year, you know, you remember the pain, but also the joy, because I can think of no better way to remember my son than with a scholarship being awarded to
some
deserving.
How are those scholarships awarded, Judge Jones, on mm-hmm. what basis?
It's several criteria. One is I'm looking at economic need. I'm looking at community schools, the Logan, the San Diego High, Lincoln, Morris. I'm looking at young people that have demonstrated leadership potential and that have been accepted into a four-year school.
Are minorities sufficiently represented in San Diego today? I think I know the answer to that.
No.
How much have we improved, though, since the time when you were a youth?
Yeah, I think it's improved an awful lot. I can remember when Leon became the first. So obviously, you know, we've certainly seen a progression there. We certainly have minorities and African Americans in some very prestigious positions. All of that is good. But we still, I think, have a problem accepting people. As Dr. King said, not based upon the color of their skin, but the content of their character.
Your parents talked about education. Is education one of the answers to having better minority representation?
Absolutely. Absolutely. It's a very complex society, and it's going to become more complex, and you have to be educated. You have to be educated to compete.
Tell us what San Diego was when you were a little kid in the 40s and 50s, what we are today and what we should be tomorrow.
One of the beautiful things, I grew up in a community, Logan Heights, and it was a very cohesive community. If I got out of line, the neighbor could call me in and discipline me, and then call my parents, and they'd discipline me again for upsetting my neighbor. But it was that kind of a village atmosphere. So it was a very cohesive and supportive community. It's not that anymore. I think it's a community that's in transition. There's a lot of people moving in and out, but the warmth and the structure that I felt as a youth, I think, is missing. That's not to say it's not in other communities, but certainly not where I grew up.
Is mentoring helping, as you are with a youngster here?
Yeah, I think so, Fred. I think that young people, and you never know what's going to turn a young person on, so this past Saturday, well, the Saturday before last, we were serving pancakes at the William G. Oaks Boys and Girls Club to the young people. And you never know what little thing you might do that might turn someone on.
This is the Oaks Group.
That's the Alumni Association, yes.
Tell us about the Alumni Association.
It's headed by Leroy John Taylor, and it's a group of volunteers. We, with the exception of the women, because it was a boys' club when I was coming up, and women couldn't join, but we do have women board members that are very active, and all of the male members attended the Oaks Boys Club.
Judge Jones, with all the activities that you do around the community now, what is your single greatest passion?
Creating an atmosphere where young people are given that opportunity and they can develop themselves. I would love to see us whittle down the crime rate. Street gangs bother me. It's just not a wholesome atmosphere for my kids. So I would love to see us create a situation where we do have that nurturing community that allows them to become the best mechanic or teacher or whatever they desire to be.
What kind of community is San Diego today, and what should we be tomorrow?
I think that, you know, we're a community that's sectioned off, and we're a city with several communities. We don't certainly have that cohesiveness that we used to have. And I think that, you know, we have to reach out more. It's so easy to have a we-they mentality, and the we-they mentality is deadly. We can't afford that.
Napoleon Jones, who are you?
I'm a God-fearing person that loves very deeply my fellow citizens.
What are we looking at here?
That's my heart. That's my wife, Dr. Rosalind Baxter Jones. She's an OBGYN. And I guess one of the smart things I did was to marry a doctor. So as I tend and continue to age, I can get good care.
What don't we know about you?
I think that probably the deep, deep, deep commitment I have to family. The priorities were taught by my family, and I haven't changed them, but it's always been God, family, and community.
What do you like best about yourself? Is that one of the things you like?
I like that. I like the fact that I am very God-fearing. I'm very supportive of my family, and I certainly want to be a positive part of the community.
If you could change something about yourself, what would you change?
Well, you know, I've been very blessed, Fred, so it's when you say that, it's kind of hard because I really have, you know, a young man from Logan Heights, from Hodge, and they don't even call it a city, it's called a village of Hodge, but to be appointed by a president to a federal bench, I've been very blessed.
Secret of your success?
My dad and mom would not allow me to use the word can't. Never. I used to think I had the meanest parents in the world. I would have to do my homework. I had friends that I could go out and play and go to dances, do whatever, but I had to do my homework. I could only go out one night a week, and if I went out that night, I'd better get up and go to church, because you can't go out and then not get up and go to church. So I had a family, I had parents that loved me enough to raise me, Fred.
Most impressive person And you've dealt with so many wonderful people that you've ever met.
Aside from my family?
Mm-hmm.
I think probably it's an attorney named Luther Goodwin, who is also deceased. But he gave me the first clerkship job when I was in law school. And he taught me an awful lot.
Napoleon, what haven't you done that you would still like to do?
I want to do some more traveling. We have a senior judge, and this is just unbelievable, named Howard Turrentine. He's 92 years old, and Howard is always going somewhere. And I think on his 92nd birthday, he was hunting in Mexico. But he's just an incredible, incredible person, a memory that is unbelievable.
You're going to help me get him on the Heart of San Diego.
You would enjoy him. He is just truly delightful.
You deeply believe in God.
Mm-hmm.
What else? Family?
Family and community. I think that as a people, we have to understand that we are a people and we need to support each other.
What turned you on quickly and what turned you off?
I don't like bigotry, stupidity, hate. That's an emotion that's like cancer, just eats you up.
And Judge Jones, how would you like to be remembered by your community?
A person that cared and that he tried. And he moved and was motivated by love, not hate.
What a great show. Thank you so much. Judge Napoleon Jones has been our guest here on the Heart of San Diego. My name is Fred Lewis. We're here on ITV and we're brought to you by two wonderful organizations, the San Diego Foundation and Manchester Financial. I'm Fred, of course, and I'll see you soon right here on the Heart of San Diego. Copies of these programs are available by calling 858-200-7727. They can be viewed at the San Diego State Media Center.